Checkpoint Theatre presents Vulnerable, written and performed by Cheyenne Alexandria Phillips, dramaturged and directed by Huzir Sulaiman, with music and sound design by Shah Tahir. 4. Locked Away.
The lead up to lockdown. When I decided to pursue art as a career choice, I told myself I would commit to at least one major project a year. Start out with something manageable. So in 2016, just before graduating with a science degree, I designed the lights for a Fringe Festival show. 2017, I co-wrote and performed in my first independent work and displayed an art exhibition. 2018, I went on residency to a remote tropical paradise and presented a piece for the Singapore Writers' Festival. 2019, I was developing new work and going to tour guide school. 2020 was to see the outcomes of those two projects. 16 January 2020, I am found competent and awarded my tour guide license. 17 January 2020, I go in for the first read of my new work prior to starting rehearsals. It's called A Grand Design. It would have been the first piece of work I produced with Checkpoint Theatre. After 17 January 2020, a series of unfortunate events followed. 23 January, Singapore reports its first case of COVID-19. 7 February, Singapore raises its DORSCON level to orange. The disease is in Singapore, but is contained, and measures need to be taken to keep it that way. My teaching gigs the following week are cancelled. 10 February, the festival that A Grand Design is part of is cancelled, and the show is postponed. 20th February, I take a 3-hour journey to and from town to pick up a white elephant, my tour guide license. 5th March, I head down to hear what the authorities have to say about supporting the arts. Sounds promising, but also not. 8 March, I attend what I did not know would be my last arts event in person for the year. 23rd March, it is announced that the Singapore International Festival of Arts is cancelled. It's 2 months after the first case was found. 27 March, I stay at home. In a different universe, I would be performing today. The speed at which the arts industry had its events cancelled and or postponed was phenomenal. Never has government bureaucracy moved so fast. Grant outcomes take 6 to 8 weeks, grant disbursement can take forever. Closing an industry happened just as quickly as snapping our fingers.
My fellow Singaporeans.
3rd April 2020. Our Prime Minister drinks from a magic blue cup that gives him the power to speak in 3 of our 4 official languages. It does not matter which speech you listen to. The news is the same. We are going into lockdown on the 7th of April. Use the weekend to get your shit together. You can bet he said it in a nicer way. 6 April 2020. It is hours before Singapore goes into lockdown. I wear a mask to a recording studio, even though it is not compulsory yet. This is the last thing I have to do before it cannot be done. This is the night we record A Grand Design, an audio experience. I text one of my producers and friend, waves to your HDB when I reach the studio, because we are recording it across the street from her. She doesn't come. Neither does our stage manager. The fewer people there are, the safer everyone is. I have told my colleagues this. I've never been in a recording studio before. The microphone is daunting. It doesn't have eyes, but I know it is staring at me. It will be my worst critic. It will pick up every shaky word, every mispronunciation. I'm afraid it will pick up the pounding heartbeat I can feel in my ears. I look at my director and sound designer. They look back at me with their mask-covered faces, eyes watching knowingly. We only have tonight to do this. This is the only window we have. I reach home about 45 minutes before the lockdown officially begins. There is nothing else to do but sleep. Lullaby. It's too quiet. 2 a.m. has never been this quiet. At least not in the East. Not in the top floor apartment I've lived in for over 20 years, with a view of the airport tower from my bedroom window. I cannot sleep. There is no roar of an engine in the sky above. A lullaby I share with the midnight travelers going to and fro. A motorcycle dashes by. Someone shouts. Then, nothing. My breath is loud enough to echo through the room. The aircon hums a lonely song. I count imaginary flights, leaving the runway, hoping for sleep to take off. Minor situation. Since we started staying home, we've been cooking and eating more in the house. This has invited minors to sit on our windows and laundry rack, peer into the kitchen and check out what is being served. It starts with one bird, then it becomes 2. Then the whole gang arrives. They have not got the message about social distancing. These miners start being really noisy. They squawk at each other, have loud conversations. We hear them and chase them away. They get stealthier and do not let a peep out of their beaks. They can't do anything about their feet hitting the metal of the laundry rack though. If the TV isn't on, I can hear them and I have to go be my own house cat. Mom buys this fake owl online. It's a hollow ornamental piece that I assume would be in gardens or on shelves. It is life-size and I suppose from far away it looks like a real spotted wood owl. She buys the owl to scare away the miners. She puts it on the laundry rack, facing out the window. If our neighbours did not know any better, they would probably call animal rescue on us. The owl works! The smaller miners do not even come to the window. The big one perches at the end of the laundry rack, staring the owl down. One day, Dad finds the big miner trying to have a conversation with our plastic owl. That is the day the big miner learns that we have played a trick on him. He daringly moves towards the plastic owl, determines it is no threat, and ventures into the kitchen, looking for a snack. Mom decides to increase her defenses and buys another owl, one that makes hooting sounds when it detects motion. That doesn't work either. Now we have 2 plastic owls in the kitchen, real miners coming in and out whenever they like. If I find a way to introduce pelicans and flamingos in my home, I can open a bird park in the East and charge decent admission. useless. How many classes can one audit in a year? How many resumes can one send out? How many proposals can one submit? How many pitches can one make? How many courses can one sit for? How many certificates can one get? How many qualifications can one achieve? How many years of experience must one have? How long does one need to realize it's all still useless? The Friend Group, 13 May 2020. The friend group Roxanne and I share has been driving me crazy. Please don't take this the wrong way. I'm glad that my friends have jobs. I'm glad that despite the pandemic, their careers are still intact. I'm excited that some of them have found better opportunities even. But I really don't need them telling me that since I have so much free time now, I should make them suji cake and have it delivered to their houses in this circuit breaker period. Like that was my main purpose now, to supply my friends with food. I don't have free time. I lost everything. I couldn't start with my licensed tour guide career because, hello, where are all the tourists? I was supposed to perform in a show this year, but that was cancelled. Everything else I did to make money instantly disappeared. And here my friends think I'm going to make them suji cake and send it to them for free, is it? This is getting worse. A couple of nights ago, the topic of money came up. What does everyone make? How much does everyone have? I might be the first person on record to be kicked in the stomach in a Zoom meeting. I tell Roxanne and our typical game night crew how I felt about the conversation. It was unnecessary to bring this up, especially when you guys are aware of my situation. They reassured me. Drop a text and we will help change the subject. And I trust them. Money doesn't come up often, but work does sometimes. I pretend I have something big coming up every time, even if I am just talking about the same gig. I play it up like it's a big deal, and sometimes it is. Most of the time, it is so I don't get looked on in pity, or so I don't feel like my life decisions are being questioned. Roxanne is the loudest cheerleader every time. She floods our chat group with so much excitement and praise, I swear I can hear her voice through her text. I suspect it might be genetic. Once, I had books delivered to her as part of a lockdown book exchange. When the Grab delivery guy arrived at her door, her grandparents thought the dude was my staff, delivering the books to her, as though I were that cool and important and successful a writer. I'm not. But it really made me feel good for a moment. It was really small, but I really appreciated that. A day in a life. Cheyenne is playing writer. Every morning, she puts on day clothes, has her breakfast, sips her hot drink, the one that is supposed to keep her awake. She sits at her desk, scrolling through emails. Nothing new, nothing outstanding. She flips through social media, catching the news of the day. Some days, she sits through a lesson she started a few days ago. She puts the lesson on her to-do list, like it was something important. For lunch, she heats leftovers and watches her favorite TV sitcom, the one with the pretty blonde actress who barely gets a gig. She makes a hot drink after lunch. She scrolls through her email again. Nothing new, nothing outstanding. She reads and researches, which is sometimes code for poking around the internet. She types sometimes, not as frequently as she would like. The words are not as graceful as she hopes. Some days, she looks up submission details. She reads the work of others. Then she thinks there is no point submitting. She has dinner with her family. They have occupied their own spaces in the day. Cheyenne falls asleep watching the pretty blonde actress character give up her daydream. At night, Cheyenne dreams of ways to keep a daydream alive.
Vulnerable is developed and produced by Checkpoint Theatre. To support the creation of original Singapore work, please make a donation to Checkpoint Theatre at www.giving.sg. Checkpoint Theatre's Vulnerable, produced by Huzir Sulaiman and Claire Wong, written and performed by Cheyenne Alexandria Phillips, dramaturged and directed by Huzir Sulaiman, sound engineering, music and sound design by Shah Tahir, production stage manager is Sumono, assistant dramaturg Mao Yen Tay, marketing and publicity by Lum Ishawn and Jane Lim, additional support by Nicole Wong. If you have the time, we would love to hear from you. Please give us your feedback by following the link in this episode's description.